Finally, we are going to finish with case study number 6, which deals with diagnosis and therapy of C. difficile infection, ranging from mild, moderate disease to severe disease. This case is a 66-year-old Caucasian male in good health who was seen 3 weeks earlier by his physician with an acute presentation of cough and congestion with a temperature of 101 without any respiratory discomfort. He is a non-smoker and he took care of the grandchildren the prior week, both who exhibited URI symptoms. He received treatment with levofloxacin for 10 days. His only chronic medical problem related is heartburn, for which he takes a daily protein pump inhibitor. He returns again to his physician 11 days later after completing his antibiotic therapy, now with a 2-day history of watery diarrhea, hemocult-positive stool, and passage of mucus in the stool. He is afebrile with mild cramping, abdominal pain, and physical exam without significant findings, except for increased bowel sounds. He is not dehydrated with his laboratory values normal, except for a white blood cell count of 12,000. He has normal electrolytes and creatinine of 0.9, and his EIA testing for C. diff toxins A and B was positive. His physician initiated metronidazole 500 milligrams orally 3 times per day for 10 days. He was diagnosed with mild to moderate C. difficile infection. By day 7, diarrhea was profuse, fever was noted with a temperature of 102 degrees Fahrenheit, and he was exhibiting marked cramping, abdominal discomfort, and decreased bowel sounds, although he was not toxic in appearance. His laboratory values included a white blood cell count now elevated to 19,000 with 80% granulocytes, 10% bands, and 10% lymphocytes. He had a creatinine of 2.1. He was admitted for hydration, a CT scan of his abdomen, close monitoring, a possible surgery, GI, or ID consultation. His serum lactate level was pending. Vancomycin was initiated and was started at 125 milligrams orally 4 times per day for 10 to 14 days. The metronidazole was stopped. He was assessed for complications for his severe CDI. All right, Dr. Kochmar, you want to comment?
Thank you, Dr. Rye. What we want to do with case study 6 is look at the diagnosis and treatment of C. difficile infection, mild to moderate disease to severe disease, because the most important point as we address the new virulence with C. difficile is the monitoring of the patient to determine the level of severity of the C. difficile infection. This will determine treatment modalities and absolutely the need for surgical consultation to follow along with the physician the status of the patient. The important elements then that we're seeing with this new virulent organism is not the commonplace age, underlying disease such as leukemia or some chronic disease that makes you more risk for C. difficile, and antimicrobial utilization. But with this new virulence of the organism, where there's a almost fivefold increase colectomies in children from the children hospital studies, including 1/3 of the isolates being this new C. diff, where there's been a doubling of C. diff in the hospital for adults. But what we want to do is realize that if the patient presents with diarrhea, that there may be no other risk factors that may indicate you need to run the test for C. difficile, and you're going to have to factor this into your differential. This has occurred because probably the use of proton pump inhibitors with respect to stomach acids, and now the most common drug used in North America, quinolones, where all these hypervirulent strains now are resistant to quinolones, we have created a situation where we now have an inpatient, outpatient situation with C. diff and all age patients with a diversity of presentations. So when someone presents and they're having more than 3 stoolings a day in the adult patient, and you run that test for C.difficile toxin A and B, realize that the sensitivity is 63% to 94% and the specificity is 75% to 94%. So it's a good test that ELISA tests for toxin A and B, but it's not a great test. And now with the availability of the PCR testing for C. diff, which has a sensitivity approaching 94% and a specificity of 95% to 98%, that may help solve our testing problem with no ideal situations. What is most important with the case just presented in C. diff is looking at the factors that help us decide whether this is a severe disease process in your patient or a non-severe process. And the variables clearly stated by recent guidelines just published over the last few months from the Infectious Disease Society of America and other national groups include the fact that you want to monitor CBC, you want to monitor creatinine, and you want to monitor to see if your patient is progressing to significant colitis. So if it's mild to moderate disease, this is the patient who is having diarrhea. This is the patient who's having maybe mild abdominal cramping, nothing significant, whose white count is less than 15,000, and his creatinine is not greater than 1.5 times what is the baseline creatinine for your patient. This is the patient where a comfort level of recommendation is 500 milligrams of metronidazole 3 times a day for 10 to 14 days is usually adequate. Realizing that adequate means that the relapse rate for C. diff disease with the old strains is still 10-15%, but now with the new strain with a 15% mortality potential, the recurrence rate in some situations, especially the Canadian studies, was as high as 40% plus. If your patient then progresses from mild to moderate disease on the initial presentation, has a white count greater than 15,000, a serum creatinine greater than 1.5 times the baseline of that patient, and especially if their age is greater than 65, then this is considered a severe disease status. And with a severe disease status on that initial presentation or progression to that status, vancomycin would be the drug of choice based on most recent studies for severe status with 125 milligrams oral vancomycin every 6 hours. What you are monitoring for is severe disease with complications. This could be ileus. This could be a CT scan showing you thickened bowel. This could be ascites. This could be megacolon. This could be hypotension. Could be shock. You may even have some dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. With those severe, complicated situations, number one, drug of choice, 500 milligrams of vancomycin given every 6 hours. If there is ileus, a retention enema with 500 milligrams of vancomycin in 100 milliliters of normal saline would be placed. And the patient also would receive IV metronidazole, 500 milligrams IV, every 8 hours. As soon as you have a severe status situation, the surgery colleague should be involved. Since by the time a lactate level reaches 5, or by the time a white count starts approaching 50,000, the mortality rate of trying to do a colectomy on those patients is approximately 75%. And thus, the bottom line from this case to appreciate is, as you look up the information I've just shared with you, the continuous monitoring for the level of severity of the patient and having your surgical colleague and your ID consultant involved in these cases becomes more germane. Dr. Rai, any additional comments?
Thanks, Dr. Kochmar, for that great summary of C. difficile infections in both the pediatric and adult populations. I just have a couple of things to add to what you said. I just want to make sure that our audience understands that you cannot use IV vancomycin for the treatment of C. difficile infections. Some people think that if you can use PO vancomycin that you would also be able to use IV, but that's not the case. You can use PO metronidazole or IV metronidazole, but usually those are not used together. In addition, I would like to just kind of comment on the fact that with the second recurrence of C. difficile infection, vancomycin pulse or taper dosing is the modality of choice. Whereas I think before it was said that you can have basically two rounds of metronidazole before you go to PO vancomycin. Now we're kind of going with one round of metronidazole before you start PO vancomycin.
I would like to thank you at the end of these cases for joining us for this session. Certainly, antimicrobial resistance and healthcare associated and community associated infections affects the public health. That is why for almost 10 years you have seen DHEC committed to addressing judicious use of antibiotics with the most recent focus on a look at the changing domain of resistance actively in the community that's affecting our patients. That is why today we tried to present some real-life clinical cases that you may be addressing in your patients. And our goal was that maybe your patients would have an improved clinical outcome instead of a poor outcome such as increased mortality or even morbidity, which we are certainly seeing with these unique hypervirulent and resistant infections. I thank you for joining us, and I hope you have found this session valuable.